Hello learners, I welcome you all to this session. I am Mohini Arora and we will be studying today Fundamentals of Internet and Java Programming for the students of Computer Science course. So let's begin the session. First, I will tell you the objectives that we will be covering for this session. We will explaining various technologies used in Internet. You will use various services provided by the Internet, email, search. Search for desired information over internet, explain the features of World Wide Web, explain the utility of Java programming language and its characteristics, and identify the relationship between Java and internet. So let's start covering these topics one by one. First, we talk about internet, a very familiar name nowadays for all of you. Internet is network of networks. The history of internet goes back to US around 1950s when ARPANET was born. It was made for defense agencies of USA. They wanted to connect into one network. That is how the beginning of internet started. And today it is a huge network that spans not one city, not one office, not one country. It spans across the globe. All small and large networks around the world have joined together to form internet. So various services are being used of internet these days, like email, FTP, Telnet, World Wide Web and many others, but we will be covering these services in this particular session today. And internet, the communication on internet happens through TCP/IP. The transmission control protocol and the internet protocol. So these two protocols help us to communicate data, information across two or more devices on the internet. So let's talk about the services one by one. First, email or electronic mail. It is the paperless method of sending messages across the network. It's a very fast means of communication and cheap means of communication that is available throughout the year 24/7, all days, anytime it is available. And the recipient may not be available all the time to receive the messages. The messages can be delivered to the inbox and whenever the recipient is free, he can check on the messages. So a very useful service, very widely used service of internet is email. This screen here shows you the components of an email address. It has the recipient name as the first portion. In this example, John is the recipient name. Then every email address has got an identifier, that is @. And next, Hotmail. Hotmail is the mail server, mail service provider, under whose service I have created the internet connection. There are many mail services providers, for example, Gmail. When you create an ID, an email ID using Gmail, then the name changes to @gmail.com. Similarly, if you use Yahoo service provider, it changes to yahoo.com. So depending on the mail service that you are using, this section of email, the name changes accordingly. Then you have .com, the third and final part of an email address, which specifies the type of organization that my service provider belongs to. There are various categories of organizations that you can see in the next slide also. .com, that means it's a commercial institution. .edu, educational institution. .gov, that is government site. .mil, a military site. .net, that means it's a gateway or an administrative host of networks. .org, that means private organizations. So depending on the category in which this particular mail service provider falls, accordingly the last section of the email changes. It can be .com, .edu, .org, anything depending on the type of category that the mail service falls in. Next, we move on to file transfer protocol. A protocol is a set of rules that have to be followed while communicating on the internet, on any network for that matter. So FTP is the protocol that governs the transfer of files between the sender and the receiver. So it's an internet utility software used to upload and download files. It gives access to directories or folders on remote computer. I want a file that is stored on some other computer, and my computer and the sender's or the other computer is connected to each other through the network. So, using FTP, I can upload the file from there, or I can even send or download the file to that particular place. It allows software, data, and text files to be transferred between different kinds of computers. NFTP is basically used to give flexibility and promote sharing of computer programs, files, and data. They are very reliable, they transfer data reliably and more efficiently over the network. They encourage the use of remote computers. I cannot be present anywhere and everywhere, but my people who are working with me might be present anywhere across the world. So, rather than physically people going and delivering files, it can be done through the internet using FTP. So, I can remotely access the file, make changes in it, return it back without physically sending any person or without physically any person coming to me to give me the files. And it shields a user from variations in file storage system among the hosts. So, the user's identity may not be always revealed, it can be shielded also. Only the computer that is being given access may be used to transfer that particular file. So, this is what is FTP. Then we move on to Telnet. Telnet gives me the access for remote computing. I can log in to any computer which I may not be authorized to, but I am giving permission. I may not be part of that particular network, but I am given permission to access that particular remote network or remote computer for a particular task to be performed. So, that can be done through Telnet. It's a telecommunication utility software. It allows you to become a user on a remote computer with proper permissions and with proper authenticity. Once you gain access to the remote computer, you can use it for any intended purpose. So, this is what is Telnet. Next, we move on. How can I initiate a Telnet session? How can I, my computer which is there on my desk right now, how can I form a Telnet session with some other computer that is there, that is far away from me, that is a part of some other network? So, the slide here shows you the steps to initiate a Telnet session. First, you start up the Telnet program. You give the address that you want to connect to, proper URL or proper address of that IP address or any other relevant address of that particular computer has to be given. Make a note of what the escape character it is, that means how will you move out of that particular session. Log in to the remote computer. Set the terminal emulation. Emulation here means that it appears as if it is your own terminal. That is what is an emulation. So, you have to set up that particular computer as if it is your system and you are working on that very computer as if it is in front of you. That is what is an emulation. Play around, that means do the task that you want to do, and finally you can quit the Telnet session. So, you get access to a remote computer to perform a particular task only. That is what is Telnet, a very useful telecommunication utility wherein I can perform a particular task sitting at a different place on a different computer on somebody else's network. A particular task can be performed using Telnet utility. Then we talk about World Wide Web, which is a hypertext based information retrieval tool. I can access any web page using this World Wide Web. All web pages are linked through hypertext. So, that is why it is saying that it is a hypertext based information retrieval tool where I can retrieve information in the web browser because the pages are created in HTML format. All the information on internet are presented to the user as a web page, and all web pages are linked to each other through hyperlinks, and the browser is used to view the web pages. So, World Wide Web works on a browser. I can view web pages, I can view hyperlinked web pages in a web browser using the World Wide Web service. The slide now shows you a uniform resource locator. We were just talking about web pages. Every web page has got an address, a unique address, a unique place where that web page is stored. We call it as a URL or a uniform resource locator. The slide here shows you the address of the URL, how it is presented and what are the different parts of a URL. The first portion is the protocol. Here the example shows HTTP, that is Hypertext Transfer Protocol, is the first part of any URL. You have to specify the protocol that is being used for that particular web page. The second is the server. In this particular example, it says nios.org. So that is the server from where the web page that you are requesting will be retrieved. So name of the server is the second part of the URL. Third part of the URL is the path on the server where the requested page is saved. So I requested a particular page, say for example url.htm as is given on the screen. And that particular page is stored on a fold in the folder computers, in the subfolder inbtenet, and the file name is url.htm. So the complete URL is the protocol, the server, and the complete path along with the file name that I want to view in my web browser. Every web page that you request will be having these three components in its address or in its URL. So this is the URL that we have just discussed. Every URL will have the protocol, will have the server name, and will have the complete path along with the file name that a client has requested to view it on the web browser. Next, we move on to Java and C++. Both of these are languages which are used to write a program for a computer. A program is a set of instructions that are given to the computer to perform a particular task. So, internet is largely being programmed using Java. Why are we talking about C++ here? Because C++ is the first object-oriented programming language that was being used, and Java is an advanced form of object-oriented programming language. We will be discussing about object-oriented programming languages shortly. What are the features of OOPS? What are the features of object-oriented programming? But first here in this slide, we are talking about Java, which is the derivative of C and C++. It's a simple familiar syntax. When I talk about familiar, that means it is closer to the English language, easy to understand. The words are familiar to us, the instructions are familiar to us, so it is easy to learn. And it has got very few complex features. Every programmable object is an instance of a class. That is the unique feature of Java because it is an object-oriented language. And another very distinctive feature of Java is that it has got a very efficient memory management system which is based on garbage collection system. So it has got an efficient garbage collector based memory management scheme. That is also a distinctive feature of Java. So here we discuss about the characteristics of Java. Some of them I have just mentioned, that it is simple, it's flexible, it has got familiar syntax. The words that are being used to give instructions to the computer are closer to the English language. Then it is object oriented. Object oriented means it fulfills four basic object oriented criteria, that is encapsulation, polymorphism, inheritance, and dynamic binding. We discuss them one by one. Encapsulation, that means I have enclosed the data and the functions in a single unit. I have hidden them from the outside world. So it implements information hiding and modularity. I have broken the code, I have broken the data into small, small units. So they are easily manageable independent units. That is what is encapsulation. Then polymorphism. Same message being used again and again according to different requirements, according to different forms, that is what is polymorphism. So the same message sent to different objects result in the behavior that is dependent on the nature of the object receiving the message. So you will get different output. Same message sent to one object, a different output. Same message sent to a different object, a different output. So depending upon the object that is receiving and the arguments that is being given along with the message, you get a different response. That is what is polymorphism. Then an object-oriented language implements inheritance, means a particular class is using the code of the class from which it is being inherited. That is what is inheritance. You will define new class and behavior based on the existing classes to obtain a code which is reusable. You can reuse the code again and again. That is what is inheritance. And then an object-oriented language, it implements dynamic binding. When I say dynamic, means at runtime, not during compilation, during execution. So objects could come from anywhere, possibly across the network, and you need to be able to send messages to objects without knowing their specific type at the time you write the code. When you are writing the code, you don't know how the user might respond, what input the user might give. So during execution, the binding takes place. During execution, the decision of the task to be performed is taken. That is what is dynamic binding. It provides maximum flexibility while a program is executing. That is what is dynamic binding. And Java implements dynamic binding in a very, very efficient manner. Then Java is portable. Portable means it can, the program can be moved from any machine to any machine. It is easy to distribute the program written in Java from one machine to another. So it can run on any platform, any computer. Then the another characteristic of Java is it is a compiled and interpreted language. When you write a Java code, that is the source code. That source code is compiled to form the bytecode. And this bytecode is the Java virtual machine, which like the bytecode along with the interpreter, it forms the Java virtual machine, and this can run on any platform. So it is both compiled and interpreted. Till bytecode it is compiled, and after that it is interpreted to form a Java virtual machine. So this is another characteristic of Java, which is in very, very few languages. Languages are either compiled or interpreted, one of them is there. But Java is one language which is both compiled and interpreted, and which gives it the distinct advantage over other languages. Then Java is architecture neutral. Architecture neutral means it can run on any platform, any computer, any CPU, any processor, because JVM, the Java virtual machine that is formed, is architecture neutral. See, it explains the feature architecture neutral, that it generates generic bytecode which is executable on any processor. It is independent of any CPU or hardware architecture across the networks. Then Java is dynamic. When I talk about dynamic, it makes interconnections with the modules at runtime, not during compilation, but during the execution of the program. And the application are always ready to run, irrespective of change or revisions taking place, still they are running. The change may be implemented during the next execution of the program. But at present, you can very well run it. The interconnections with the functions, with the applications can happen at runtime. Next feature of Java is that it is distributed. Numerous applications of Java may be present on numerous systems and they can connect at runtime. So that is why we say that it is distributed. It has got extensive library of routines for easy distribution of applications, and all the standard protocols which are used for connectivity, which are used for communication across the networks, are compatible with Java. It is compatible with HTTP, TCP/IP, FTP, SMTP, and so on. So that is why the application may be present on any computer anywhere across the network. I can very easily access it because the compatibility factor with the protocols is always there with Java. So the applications are distributed across the network and I can access them through various protocols using the Java language. Next feature is that it has the automatic memory management. There is a feature in Java called garbage collector, which keeps track of all the memory that is being allocated. So, this garbage collector helps in efficient memory management of the programs. Java is a multi-threaded language, that means multiple tasks can be performed at one point of time using this particular language. It has got multiple threads of control and several applications can run concurrently in this particular language. It's robust and secure. Explicit memory manipulations by the programmer are prevented and it exhibits highest level of security concerns that a program can have, because it's object oriented, it's encapsulated, abstraction is implemented and various other security features are also implemented, which makes it a very robust and secure programming language as far as the data security is concerned. When we talk about Java and internet, the Java programming enables the web documents authors to deliver small application programs to anyone browsing the pages of the document. Means anyone who wants to browse any web page can be done using the Java language. The data and programs need not be stored on your computer. As I said, Java is distributed, it is dynamic. So, they need not be stored on your computer. It can connect to any network, any system, and application can bind during runtime and it can run on your web page. They can reside anywhere on the internet, called up by whosoever needs them and whenever they need them. That is what is the power of flexibility of Java language. So, this brings us to the end of this session. In this session, we have learnt about various terminologies used in internet. We have learnt about various services provided by internet, learnt how to search the desired information, features of World Wide Web, and we have discussed about the utility of Java programming language and its characteristics, and we have also talked about relationship between Java and internet. I hope this session was a learning experience for you and you gained knowledge on internet and on Java programming. Thank you.